Okay, good afternoon, everyone. I'm just going to call things to order. My name is Michael Lewin. I'm the head of Media and Public Affairs for the OPCW. And just to very briefly introduce the session, this is the first of what is going to be an extremely busy, I would say an unprecedentedly busy week of stakeholder side events for the review conference. I think at last count there were something like 10. I was here for the last review conference in 2008, my first one, and there was almost no such event. So I would say that in the realm of expanding the OPCW's relationships and engagement with stakeholders across the board, industry, academia, NGOs, think tanks, and others, the organization has come a long way, and it's continuing to make progress. So without further ado, I just want to welcome everyone. This first event is going to be a presentation of several special editions of periodicals or special reports by three different organizations about the issues that the OPCW will be dealing with in the third review conference. So without further ado, where's John? John, are you there? I'll introduce John Hart from CPRI. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I apologize for any lack of clarity on when this session was supposed to begin. I think there was some last-minute discussions on that. In any case, I've been asked to try to chair this session, so I would like to begin by thanking everyone who came, and maybe we could start with some introductions. On my left, as I'm sure probably everyone knows, is Dr. Ralph Trapp. I don't know if he needs any further introduction, but
At this point in time, independent consultant on chemical arms control issues, previously with the OPCW.
And on my right is Dr. Elisanda Nexon, who is also in the agenda for this section. I don't know if you want to. I shouldn't say anything else, should I?
Here for the non-proliferation monthly, so okay. On behalf of CESIM.
Okay, thank you. And to her right is Richard Guthrie from CBW Events. Should you?
I'll just talk.
Okay. Okay, so I think what we will do is try to be short and brief, and perhaps we could start according to the agenda, I believe. The first one is this. So this is basically to introduce a final version of a report, which has been published last week. It is available on the internet. There are paper copies, or published copies, to the left of me on the stone wall. So we would like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to participate in this meeting and to present this report. And we would like to thank all of those who supported and facilitated this project, including the funder. I should say also that the views expressed are those of the authors, and they do not necessarily reflect those of their respective organizations. Two of the co-authors could not be here. Dr. Dowdy and Dr. Lele had other commitments, but they send their regards and their regrets. So I would like to maybe mention a few background points. Yes, thank you. So a couple of words on why we wanted to do this report. There were various reasons, but perhaps I could mention three. One is we thought that we would like to produce something that is reasonably short and policy-oriented, which also has longer-term relevance, including after the third review conference, and one which can, in principle, inform strategic policy planning while also reflecting some of the operational detail. And the problem also is that if one goes too much into detail, the detail takes over the entire report. But hopefully the report has a good balance that gives some aspects of both strategic policy planning and operational detail. So the report has three main themes. One of them is to say a few words about the Chemical Weapons Convention in the international security context. A second is to discuss certain selected topics in science and technology trends and their impact on the Chemical Weapons Convention. And the third is preparedness and response. And for the recommendations, if you have a copy of the paper report, if you look on page 33 through 35, you will see some recommendations that are focused specifically for the third review conference, but also have longer term relevance. So a couple of words about international security scene. Many of these things are very well known, so I apologize in advance. but there are ways in which to bring the discussion further in a useful manner, I think. And our thinking is that we should try to leave as much time as possible for discussion. But in any case, there are many people who have commented on how the international security scene has a more diffuse set of actors with overlapping agendas and mandates, and the Cold War paradigm has ceased to exist. However, some of the elements may be coming back a little bit. And also, one can get into some specifics maybe later in the discussion. Also, these are three major points: universality, full and effective implementation, maintaining and strengthening institutional capacity. I won't say anything further on those, except perhaps in the discussion. Now I'd like to turn over to Dr. Trapp, who will speak to the next slide. Thank you.
Thanks, John. I will not actually talk you through the report. I think that would take us too long, and it's also not necessary. Plus, I don't want to take the pleasure off you of reading it, actually, afterwards. But let me just highlight a couple of things. As John already pointed out, some of the areas we are covering in this report relate to science and technology and what's happening in the chemical industry, and then also to aspects of preparedness and response. And flowing from that are also some comments that have to do with outreach, training, cooperation, the role of the OPCW in a broader context. So just a few words on science and technology and on chemical industry. I'm really only giving you some of the catchwords. You've heard them all before. We've talked about convergence between chemistry and biology. We've talked about advances in the chemical industry, new technologies, new types of production units that are being used. And just in parentheses, what really matters for the verification context of the Chemical Weapons Convention, of course, is what happens in the industry, not necessarily what happens at the benchtop in a laboratory. That is a first step in this direction. But when we talk about implementation and verification measures, what really matters is what changes industrial production of chemicals. So I'm not really going to point out any particular new aspects in this context, but what it lets us to discuss is how relevant the verification system in the chemical industry is that we have today, and how relevant it would be in the future if it would continue the way it is. If you remember, at the end of the negotiations, one of the things that was put together in quite some haste, and those of you who those of us who were there will remember this, was the what we call today the OCPF regime. It was basically an attempt to rescue whatever ideas we had that could be agreeable in the context of the Conference on Disarmament for a broader industry verification system. It was not something that was designed over many years. There were aspects of it that had been discussed in the past. But basically, we had something where we knew we needed to do more than just the schedules, but we didn't quite know how to do it and what to do. And we kept the options open for updating the system, for reviewing it, for adapting it to changes in the industry, which we would have to do in any case. The practice, as you all know, has been slightly different from that anticipation, and we find it very difficult to actually move in new concepts, change existing concepts, adapt them to changing circumstances in the industry. And the report that we've prepared here doesn't necessarily offer any particular solutions to those issues or doesn't necessarily say what needs to be done. But the point here really is that I think we need a more fundamental discussion of objectives amongst the states' parties at some point soon. We're still in a shape where I think it is justified to say that the verification system is working fine, everybody is more or less happy with it. But we had, for a very long period of time now, for 16 years, a focus on quantitative aspects without actually trying to improve the system itself. We've looked at numbers of inspections, we've looked at selection mechanisms. That's all important and that needs to be continued. The question is still today, and will be even more in the future, are we inspecting the right facilities and for the right reasons? And that's something that doesn't necessarily lead into an amendment of the convention, but it may well lead to it. I don't know what the answer to the questions is in the future, but it's a conversation that I think states parties will have to undergo to go into at some point in time, because if they don't do that, then we will have a system that will no longer in the future reflect the actual underlying security concerns which verification is supposed to answer. The verification system that we have has been built against the experience we had from past chemical weapons programs. And as long as these past chemical weapons programs and programs of a similar nature, in other words, programs that are there to develop and produce and put into the arsenals such things as nerve agents, mustard gas, and other chemical warfare agents, as long as that's the concern, then the verification system that we have is a very pertinent one. But the more we move away from these old programs and the more people start worrying about other types of chemical agents, about other types of chemical warfare perhaps, the more we need to ask ourselves whether we're actually verifying the right places and for the right reasons. So that's one plea, that we really should at some point start, and the review conference, by the way, is not the place to do that. The review conference is perhaps the place to raise awareness of the issue and get people to start thinking about it. But we do need a conversation that we've found very difficult in the past about what do we mean when we talk about risk to the object and purpose on the convention in the context of chemical industry and its completely legitimate activities and undertakings. So that's one of the things that I wanted to highlight in this context. A second one that I wanted to highlight has to do with preparedness and response, where I think we've already seen clearly a shift from a perception that the main purpose of Article 10 in the past was seen by many people as the development of a response mechanism to the use of chemical weapons, and that is still obviously an important aspect of it. But I think even more important, in particular in the changing security context and circumstances that we face today and in the future, is it to work towards a stronger preparedness at the state level, to have the organization be a platform, a facilitator of exchanging of experience, of technology, knowledge, that will help states set up robust systems in the area of preparedness and response. And as this happens, the OPCW will have to become a partner of a range of other organizations, because states will have to address these issues in a much more holistic issue. They don't come from a sort of chemical weapons perspective. They come from a perspective that appreciates their specific security situation, also their specific geographic, industrial, and other situation, other aspects. And so states will have to take, to a large degree, a holistic approach, and approach that as a CBRN issue or a CBRNE issue, or as an issue that also brings in other domains, such as both state and non-state actors, such as the question of deliberate and non-deliberate releases of toxic materials or of biological agents and other things. If that is taken as the sort of evolving framework within which the OPCW is there to facilitate and to help countries develop their capabilities, then to me at least it's obvious that the OPCW needs to be able to operate in a much broader context with a range of other organizations and agencies internationally that come from very different backgrounds. One of the things that we highlight a little bit in this report as an opportunity, really, is the evolving concept of the establishment of CBRN centers of excellence that is pursued by the European Union. This is an example I'd like to underline, that we're not trying to make a plea specifically for those centers, but to us this was an example to highlight a development that could be useful, and where the OPCW could be a useful partner if it is prepared to engage with other agencies in this context and become partner of a broader network, and also if it starts to use these things for more effective interagency coordination. And I think I'll stop there and hand it back to John.
Thank you very much. Maybe we could have that last slide and keep it on the screen a little bit. I think in the interest of time, since there's something else scheduled fairly soon, I think my proposal is to go to the next speaker, Richard Guthrie, and then Elisanda Nexon, and then perhaps we could have the questions and discussion at the end and stay as long as you like. Is that okay? And neither of you have PowerPoint present. Okay. So, okay, thank you. Richard, maybe you're next on the agenda.
Thank you very much. It's very interesting to be here. For those who are not familiar with what the idea of CBW events is, the idea is to be able to, it's mostly historical, but to break down what happened in the past into discrete chunks where you can end up with a better understanding of how things developed. But using some of that material, and as a sort of side aspect, also do a number of engagement activities. One of the things that's just often not recognized clearly enough on an issue such as this or on biological weapons is the difficulty of a lot of smaller countries to provide sufficient information for their people who are out on delegation. And this does create some hindrance. The first thing I'm going to talk about is this large book that many of you may have seen around called The Resource Guide. For various reasons, it's not called a briefing book. In the nuclear and in the biological spheres, the equivalent's called a briefing book. There are historical reasons I won't bore you with. The precedent for these was really what was going on in a group called the Mountbatten Centre for International Studies in the UK, who produced the first briefing book that was in relation to the NPT. It was then felt a very useful model, and ones were produced for first the Biological Weapons Convention and now Chemical Weapons Convention. For the CWC ones, in the book in 2008 was funded by the Germans and the Dutch, and this one for this year is being funded by the UK Foreign and Commonwealth Office, for which obviously myself and Harvard Sussex Programme, who are the co-creators of this, are very grateful. Just to quickly run through some of the why some of the documentation may be useful. I mean, it's quite obvious that things like having copies of the previous review conference final declarations to hand is very useful. There's a particular thing that was very noticeable for the equivalent book in Geneva in December 2011, was that people started referring to the page numbers of the briefing book rather than the page numbers of the documents of the previous review conferences. And that was actually very useful because it made it very easy for those who had copies of the book to go, oh yes, that's on page 47, rather than finding the document and finding the relevant page. So when it gets to the stage of comparing things, I would encourage you all to use the page numbers of the resource guide because it speeds up a lot of the work. There's the originals of the action plans, some of the materials from the Scientific Advisory Board, and the advisory panel, which I think the significance of which is not always recognized. This was the group that discussed issues in 2011 about the future priorities for the OPCW. And there's materials from related treaties. Specifically, for those who haven't been familiar with it, there has been some discussion about whether the CWC process could gain some advantages from looking at the way the Biological Weapons Convention structures its final documents in the last couple of review conferences. So the 2011 BWC final document is in here. And then there's a number of documents from the United Nations and other organizations, including the key resolutions in relation to the investigation mechanism, which we heard a certain amount because of the issues with Syria. The whole lot is also available on the website, cwc2013.info, and there are electronic copies. It feels, after spending many hours putting something like that together, it feels like a huge achievement, and then you copy it onto something small as that, and you think, was the effort all worth it? But the electronic versions are very useful because most of it is searchable. Also on the electronic versions, there are larger documents that it was not possible to put into the printed text. For example, the text of the convention itself is so large, it would have dominated a book like this. But it's in all the official languages on the electronic copies. And on the website, as other documents have been easily available that are in other official languages other than English, we've attempted to post them onto the website as well, although that's a sort of work in progress. I've only got a couple of copies over here, but there are more copies back over in the convention center. The second thing to just quickly talk about is daily reports. For those of you who've been either to the last CWC review conference or any of the BWC meetings, I produce the daily reports. They're on separate colored bits of paper, not to suggest that diplomats are forgetful, but the difficulty was in the past that people would forget which copies they'd had. They'd think, oh well, I've missed one this week, but was it two or three I missed? And so they'd pick up copies of all of the ones you'd done, which meant I printed dozens more than I needed to. Somehow people can remember they saw the green one rather than the first one, and so tomorrow's will be on a different color and Wednesday's will be on another color. Initially, these were done in Geneva for the 2006 BWC conference for people who couldn't make it to Geneva. They were found to be much more useful to a wider audience than that, and I repeated the exercise here for the 2008 review conference here, but I've also done all of the BWC official meetings in Geneva since 2006. There's now really three audiences for this. There's the NGOs that can't be present where the meeting is, that were always the traditional audience. Also found it very useful for a number of officials back in capital on the, I haven't done a tally of the chemical list, but on the biological list, about a third of all people on the list are officials back in capitals rather than NGOs, which is quite interesting to see that they're keen on it. But there's also the audience within the room. Going back to those non-specialists in these areas, diplomats, you know, the generalists who come in and do chemical weapons for a few weeks, many of them find these very useful. And so I encourage people, if there's concepts that they're finding difficult to get their head around, do mention to me that this is a concept that is difficult to understand, because I will endeavor to try and put a printed explanation for it. And as I said, I'll be doing them all the way through the review conference, and then on the week after the review conference, hopefully on the Monday, depending on how tired I am, I shall do a wrap-up one, which will be available on the web. If people want to be added to the mailing list for it, so you get it in your email in the morning rather than seeing the printed copy, please come and see me or drop me a note. My email address is the last line of the second page. And I think that's it. Thank you very much for your time.
Thank you very much, Dr. Nexon.
So thank you very much. I'll stay quite brief and present the Non-Proliferation Monthly, which is published online by a French think tank, the CESIM, with a contribution of the Foundation for Strategic Research on Chemical and Biological Issues. It is published with the support of the Delegation for Strategic Affairs from the French Ministry of Defense. But as usual, the published paper do not reflect any official position, and all opinions are solely responsibility of the authors. So the objective of this monthly is to keep the arms control community, and especially the French arms control community, informed about actualities, but also to raise awareness among a broader community, for example, among scientists and so on, who may not be aware of achievements in arms control. So there are 11 issues and a number of special issues, such as this one that you can find as sample here, about the Chemical Weapons Convention and the Third Review Conference. There are two versions, one in French and one in English. And this publication about the review conference focused on two types of issues, on key challenges and also on regional perspectives. So there are a few focus on reemergence, on the verification issue, with the point of view of the Chemical Industry Association from the United Kingdom, for example, balanced with a view from someone from the French Ministry of Economy. There is also an article from Ralph Trapp about convergence and scientific developments, as well as two papers about the African and the Asian perspective. So if you want to be added into the mailing list, just come and give me your address. Speaking about the issue of convergence, I would like to mention that we also organized a seminar in February, and that the report is available. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. So now maybe the thing to do is to try to have a discussion, if there's an interest. I don't know how to do this exactly. Maybe I call on.
Does anybody have any questions?
I don't know. Or anyone want to? Yes. Does anyone have any questions? Thank you. Yes, Mr. Ludding.
Thank you, and thank you all presenters for interesting presentations. I would ask one question about the CIPRI study. In the CIPRI study, you talk a lot about sort of the change of security environment, and the perception that the sort of state-level conflict involving chemical weapons has become less likely, and that what has perhaps become more likely is something that would involve non-state actors. Recent events have gone in a different direction, but what I would want to ask is perhaps what is your conclusion in terms of the type of changes in expertise that the organization, the OPCW, would need in order to adjust to such a sort of change of paradigm? And maybe I can ask all speakers about this. Thank you.
Okay. Sorry. When that text was being written, there were different variations of it. And every time one of the co-authors wrote something, there was a reaction, and there was also the reaction from the external reviewer. So what you see is the text that survived and text that was not agreed or for which there was a fundamental disagreement is not in the report. As far as what happens for the organization, there will always be probably varying degrees of from an institution or a capacity perspective, it's just important to have a dialogue where the points and counterpoints are discussed in an appropriate atmosphere without perhaps feeling that one has to protect a political position. So for the Secretariat, I think it's important that within certain internal discussions that one tries to be, to look at things honestly in the abstract and leave the political positions or concerns to one side. But there's no answer as such. It's more of a process, I think. And you can learn from the process of argument and counterfactual point against counterpoint. But there's not going to be an answer per se. It's just partly a function of how you formulate the text, and then there's some benefit from the interaction of discussion and argument inside the organization. I think it's important that people are able to have a certain space for more open and more honest argument or discussion, let's say. And then in some other forums, the political considerations can be appropriately factored into the equation. But there's no magic answer. It's more of a process of perhaps finding the right atmosphere and context to have more open argument and discussion, and to keep that going over the coming months and years. I guess that would be one way I could say it. But perhaps Dr. Trapp could react to it as well. Thank you.
First of all, it's coming in there as well. I mean, I don't mind who goes first.
I feel slightly embarrassed going in front of you since it's your report, but I think the key I would like to do is to actually go a step back slightly from what you said and to recognize a couple of things. One is all international instruments but inevitably embody characteristics of the time they were negotiated. You know, that's by their very nature. The key thing about the sorts of technologies and materials that we're talking about in the CWC were mostly under the control of governments when we were talking the negotiation period, or under big industry. And so it was relatively easy to think about, we will deal with big industry to stop diversion, or we will deal with governments. Now, many of these materials and technologies are highly disseminated. They are economically extremely significant, so they have to be dealt with in a careful manner that doesn't inhibit the peaceful uses. And this creates a fundamental verification problem, because the OPCW can't be everywhere. Governments find it difficult to understand what's always operating within their jurisdiction. But I think there is a new role in terms of organizations such as the OPCW being more of a coordination body for awareness raising amongst a whole range of institutions, from industry associations, learned societies. I mean, all of these things go across governmental boundaries. There's a reaction of many governmental officials to go, well, anything that's not within the remit of the OPCW should be done on a national level. But if you've got a multinational company that's operating in six countries, which of those governments is supposedly responsible for pursuing certain elements, such as, you know, awareness raising of the use of those, potential use of those materials? So I think there's a role for the international framework to get more involved in those issues. And the OPCW, I think, is in a very good position to do that. The difficulty, concern that I have, is that a lot of these activities are quite hard to measure in sort of modern management speak. There's a lot of government by accountants that goes on, where people only want to do activities that are measurable. If you can't measure it, you can't properly manage it, is something that's often referred to, within some countries. And a lot of these engagement issues are long-term activities. You can't attach a performance indicator to them. You can't show what your outcome is. But they're extremely valuable. And I think one of our challenges of the coming years is to be able to illustrate that these things are important, and to be able to persuade those that spend the money that they're important, so that these things are properly funded. But I think I see the OPCW continue its existing activities, but it would be very valuable for it to be getting involved in those. Thanks.
Thank you. Dr. Chap?
Yeah, just to briefly amplify this. If you look back at the convention and at the way we perceive the core function of the organization, of the technical secretariat, it's actually plain in the treaty itself. It says the technical secretariat is there to implement the verification activity prescribed by the convention, and then it does other things. And I think what we're seeing is a shift in emphasis. Not that verification is not important, but verification itself needs to change and needs to be rethought. At the same time, if we are moving into a situation where risks associated with non-state actors are perhaps not equally important as risks associated with state parties, but more important than they were in the past and more important than they were at the time when the treaty was negotiated, then we are moving from a system that's based on verification of state-to-state relationship and activity to something that also includes other types of risk management. That goes beyond just verification. And I mean, again, it's a question of emphasis. This is why I'd like to come back to the what Richard said in his original presentation about the OPCW advisory panel, which was an advisory panel on looking at the priorities of the organization and how they could evolve in the future. So it's not about reinventing the convention. It's not about changing anything in the treaty. It's about looking at the treaty in the current environment and say, how important are the different aspects that the treaty has in that situation, and how is this going to evolve and change in the future? And things that will then have to do with strengthening national implementation, but also strengthening preparedness at the level of countries, is perhaps more important today than it was 15, 20 years ago, or certainly different as if compared to that time frame. So the organization, the secretariat, still have these functions. They had them in the past. It's a question of how I balance them correctly so that they reflect the actual security requirements and needs of the state's parties. And in doing so, I think what we will see in reality is a move towards a broader-based risk management strategy that will be based not just on verification measures, but on a range of different activities, of which verification is one central and important aspect, but not the only one.
Maybe if I could just also summarize in two words what the technical secretariat should have is situational awareness. If it has that, however you define situational awareness, then maybe that's the way to simplify it or summarize it. It may be useful, I don't know. Any other questions or comments? Yes, Professor Karpovsky.
Thank you. Has OPCW any basis for controlling new types of chemical weapons? For example, all procedures of convention include possibilities verification, unscheduled toxic chemical, and incapacitants. Thank you.
Is this directed to anyone in particular, or Does anyone want to respond to this? Okay.
A short answer, yes, the OPCW does have. The mechanism of the schedules is one of operationalizing the verification activities. But the obligation, the core obligation of the convention about not using toxic or the toxic properties of substances as a weapon applies to any material. If there was a sufficiently significant amount of information, then mechanisms such as challenge inspection could be used to verify. It would be difficult to justify certain types of industry inspection, it is true, because there'd be materials that are not on the schedules, but it would also be possible to amend those schedules, and there are fast-track methods of doing that. If a new chemical or a new substance or family of substances were found to pose a threat. There will also be the difficulty, though, and it did happen during the negotiations, and there are people in the room who were there and would be able to answer in more detail than me, but we probably don't have the time. But there was also a tension between not just how significant a threat a particular material was, but how much economic benefit was got from the peaceful uses. So some things that you might have expected to be higher up the schedules are actually lower because of their great economic use. So the great one difficulty would be if a new class of substances were found that were potentially weapons, but had a significant industrial application, there would be quite a difficulty in defining where in the schedules they might be added. And that could be a complication.
Thank you, Dr. Trapp.
Yeah, just to add one thought to this. The sort of the standard answer has always been when we talked about schedules, chemicals that are not on the schedules but are relevant in the context of chemical weapons discussion, we have the general purpose criterion, which under Article 6 as well as under Article 2 sets prohibitions and defines in very broad terms what a chemical weapon is and what can or cannot be done. The difficulty with that answer has always been that that doesn't necessarily relate to what the organization does in practical terms. So unless we have a serious discussion about why and how we do industry verification, because I don't think I would leave that thing solely to challenge inspection and similar clarification mechanisms. They are there, but they're also quite difficult to handle in a particular political and otherwise situation. I think we need a conversation about the objectives of verification in industry with a notion of we are talking not just about scheduled chemicals as we know them today, we're talking about the general purpose criterion. And because I have some doubts about how easy it's going to be to add chemicals that are actually industrially produced at whatever scale, but they have a use. Otherwise, we wouldn't need to add them to the schedules because we would add a chemical that would never trigger an inspection. If it does trigger an inspection, we would have to be able to make a clear association between that new chemical and the possible chemical weapons intent, which is far more difficult to do with the new chemical than it was in the past when you clearly had CW programs and you could demonstrate these things had actually been put into weapons. So we're moving into a situation which is perhaps comparable to what happens to the toxins in the BW Convention. You're talking about advances in science, technology, new materials. There is a risk associated with them, but the question is, to what extent does that risk warrant an inspection or the conduct of routine verification, or is it something else we need to do? And that, I think, needs to be considered and thought about a little bit longer term.
And then there's also the discussion of derivation and use of information and sensitivities about advertising new ideas in a different setting or within the CWC regime. Sorry. Yes, Deva.
Thank you. As head of industry verification here, I come from industry and not from a diplomatic world, so forgive me if I'm a little more direct than diplomatic people. The technologies of 1997 for handling information, for receiving information, analyzing it, and disseminating it are considerably different from the technologies for today. The way I work today is dependent upon a states party bringing a paper or a CD declaration to the OPCW, and that's the only information that we have to act on. I think that we're living in another world now than we were in the 1990s. And in 5 years from now, when we come to the next review conference, Are we still going to be living in the 1990s? Are we still going to be receiving information the same way that we did in 1997? Are we still going to be analyzing it in a rather primitive way by looking at a paper report and analyzing each report one at a time? Are we still going to be responding to it through, actually, we don't really have much of a response to it. We do bilateral negotiations, and if something is particularly significant, it's brought to the EC. But I think we need to look at revitalizing our basic processes, how we receive the information, how we analyze it, and what we do with it once we have it. What good is it if it's buried in a report somewhere that one state's party sees? That's just my point, that we need to look toward the future. Thank you.
I recognize we're short of time, but very quick response to that. Yes, I think one of the great difficulties is that with a treaty text, you get locked into it, and it's quite hard to develop further. And that some of the things in relation to these things, people would want to view whether they need to amend the treaty text. But I think there are ways around it. I think the information handling thing is actually very important, because if we could work out better ways of transferring information, we could make it much cheaper for countries. And I used to have three laws of verification when I used to specialize in arms control verification, of which the third law of verification was it should be a verification measure should be cheap to comply with but expensive to cheat under. And the forms of sort of digital record keeping of things like production activities are effectively a very good record to show that something isn't being diverted, but it would be very difficult for industry to transfer that sort of data in the present scheme. But there may be ways of being able to utilize that data as well as the sort of data that's normally transmitted at really no cost to anyone, in which case, you know, it would be a great advantage, because if you've then got to fake a set of data from the sensors in your plant for the whole year, that's a huge effort. So the IT brings other benefits as well, but I suspect, John, we need to wind this up so people can get through security the other end.
Yes, I think Dr. Nexon wished to respond to this also. Thanks.
Just a quick comment. It's exactly why some in the industry call for a new mechanism to be set in place to inform about the OPCW and how to better interact with industry to improve a number of verification issues and such as this one. Thank you.
Okay, perhaps, one more question. Perun. Thanks.
Perun, former staff member and doing some work in this area still. I very much recognize what Diva said about the OPCW living mid-90s technology, but it's also very much a result of self-imposed restrictions. One cannot sit as an OPCW staff member and ask, will we? You must say, how can I change the way we work? So it's very much some kind of staff, the secretariat as such, is very scared to do anything, because the view is that unless it's explicitly permitted in the text, it's forbidden, which isn't true. A lot of things about information handling, etc., can easily be done by the secretariat if it can pull itself together.
Thank you very much. I think this session's supposed to end at 1500, and I think there's a meeting that delegations wish.
The plenary starts.
Okay, the plenary, sorry. So maybe if we could call it a wrap, so to speak. Thank you very much.